Welcome to the Tapestry of Life. I am Dr. Pascal Scoles, Professor of Behavioral Health and Human Services at Community College of Philadelphia. Today's topic is youth and behavioral health challenges. It is estimated that about 6% of adolescents between the ages of 12 and 17 should be in treatment today for substance abuse. Approximately 180,000 adolescents who enter treatment today represent only the tip of the iceberg. Adolescent alcohol consumption represents about 17 to 20% of all alcoholic beverages sold each year in the United States. 4.5 million teenagers used marijuana in 2008. It is estimated that 8% of adolescents have experimented with cocaine. The results of adolescent substance use and other behavioral health challenges is a significant factor in poor coping skills, low global functioning, low educational achievement, as well as a high incidence of suicide attempts and deaths. Today we will be discussing concerns and expectations of youth and their experiences with behavioral health issues in recovery. Once again, I would like to welcome my special guest, Rick Ford from the Department of Behavioral Health, and two guests, Keyshawn Johnson and Kareem Jamal from Youth Move Philadelphia. Maybe we can start by asking Kareem, what does Youth Move mean?
Youth Move means motivating others through voices of experience, and is basically a system of spreading other people's stories and other people's trials and tribulations, and using them to turn it into something positive.
Okay. And what kind of a story do you represent in the sense of the Youth Move?
I definitely represent a story of coming from total poverty to a well-established everyday lifestyle.
Okay. When you say total poverty, did you grow up in Philadelphia?
Yes.
Okay. Whereabouts were you?
I grew up around Allegheny, being Allegheny.
Oh, okay. And when you say poverty, can you explain a little bit about what you mean by poverty?
I mean, well, the neighborhood was really poor. Okay. It was really dirty in the neighborhood. You know, there was never much, like, our house was never, like, very well furnished. And, you know, there was always a sense of being in a struggle.
Oh, okay. How about you, Keyshawn? What's going on with you in the sense of the move to Philadelphia?
My story is based on self-esteem and a young girl dealing with self-esteem issues and body image issues, along with my father and my brother and my uncles not really being in my life, and most of them are behind bars.
Okay.
And
they're in prison now?
Yes, for several years.
Now, both of you, if I'm not mistaken, are in the 10th grade. Can you tell me a little bit about that? You're in school. What school are you in, and what's going on in school for you?
I attend Parkway Northwest High School for Peace and Social Justice, and I get good grades. And this semester, I'm proud to say that I made honor roll again.
Oh, congratulations.
It was very hard, because my first and second semester I had a D in geometry, so this semester I worked really hard, and now I have an 82 average. So it was hard because I was in a struggle of not really knowing. I was trying to find myself, dealing with low self-esteem, and I also wasn't very sure where I wanted to go in life, and I felt like I didn't really have a direction. Mm. But until a while ago, I figured out that I wanted to be an NFL coach. So now I'm working with getting internships and working my way up and dealing with my low self-esteem through success.
Yeah. Great. When you say low self-esteem, what do you mean by that? How do you conceptualize what's low self-esteem for you?
My definition of low self-esteem is just simply not loving yourself enough. Okay. And just not being satisfied with yourself. And some people, you know, oh, I have a big nose, or I have this or that, but I mean internally not loving yourself or being satisfied.
Yeah. And do you have any idea where that came from for you?
Well, I know part of it is just when I was younger, as a child, I was teased a lot.
Oh.
And they were small teased, you know, as children, oh, this, oh, that, but I guess that kind of scarred me. So when I got older, I kind of didn't really love myself, and then my father wasn't really around to tell me I was beautiful or he was proud of me. And if he did, it was through jail, you know, letters from jail, and that kind of wasn't enough. And my brother, of course, older brothers tease. That's their thing. But like, since my brother always teased and never really said good things about me, and my father wasn't there, it affected me a lot. And so I just didn't love myself inside, and I always felt like I was missing something.
Is your father in your life now?
He was out of jail for 3 days, and then he went back, and I wasn't able to see him.
Do you, I assume you still have a relationship with your mother? And
yes, I live with my mom. She's a big help with me overcoming my self-esteem.
Now, throughout all the self-esteem issues, I had a conversation earlier with you, as you know, we call it the green room, which is the cafeteria. I get the the thought that you never had any problems around low self-esteem and using drugs, for example, or alcohol to offset that low self-esteem.
Yes.
Which is kind of unique, because you know, a lot of adolescents, you feel this high incidence of addiction and, you know, drug use. But in your case, in both your cases, they didn't seem to be an issue.
When I was in the sixth grade and my brother was kind of acting up a lot, so my mom wanted a better life for us, so we moved to Georgia. And we stayed there for about 3 or 4 months. And their schooling is very different from Philadelphia. And we did a whole course on sexual education and drugs and alcohol. So I was kind of, when I came back to Philadelphia, by then I was about seventh grade, and 13, 14, that's when people begin to like use drugs and be curious. But because I had that knowledge from Georgia, I was kind of like, oh no, I know what they do to your body. And I also think it's very unattractive. Yeah.
So early on, a primary education around alcohol, drugs, and low self-esteem was very helpful in having you conceptualize a space that you didn't want to go into.
Yes.
Is that what you say? That
yes.
was what happened? Is that the same with you?
It's fairly different, because like throughout my life, like I've seen people around me, and I've seen like other people, like you can view, I mean, even other people such as you and Keyshawn, and you know, we can all see that sometimes from the outside looking in, drugs ruin families. And it does not, it not only ruins families, but it ruins people individually. And it affects the community, it affects the people around it. So when presented with the opportunity to try drugs or to take drugs, you're faced with like some choices. You're like, well, either I take it right now because my friends seem fine, but later on that can have some lasting effects that you're not willing to take the risk of. So I just say no.
And again, you indicated to me that, that drugs were not an issue in your life through your adolescence up to, how old are you now?
17.
17. And I wonder how did that happen, because you avoided a major issue that is problematic for a lot of young people.
Basically, to avoid drugs, I mean, I just saw the risk it posed to success, because sometimes it can hold you back, you know? I mean, if you look at people now who smoke cigarettes in Newports, they're like, well, I'm hungry, but I also don't have any cigarettes. They go buy a pack of cigarettes instead of feeding their stomach. I don't think that's very smart. So that definitely poses a risk to success. So I say never mind to that. Yes. So
now you both roam around in high school. You're both in the 10th grade. I'm wondering, can you give us a little insight as to what's going on in your high school? I mean, you know, we hear different stories because we're like professionals and we go into the school system, and we don't hear, I think, and know much about really what's happening in there except indirectly.
Yeah.
And I was wondering directly, I mean, you know, you're the peers, and what is going on in the school system for you, for the schools that you're in?
My ninth grade freshman year, I was at Bodine High School for International Affairs. And as I was trying to get that direction, like I said, so I transferred to Parkway Northwest. And although sometimes I miss the hard work and, you know, really getting prepped for college from Bodine, at Parkway, it's a thing called the Peace Office. And we can go inside the Peace Office, and you can just have a simple idea of wanting to start a poetry club, or you want to get your books published, and they'll have a program for you right off the bat. So, and also most classes is a lot of social debates, and I debate a lot. So if you say something I don't agree with, my hand will be raised so fast to disagree and back it up. So I like that, because I like the whole debate. I like to just hear other people's opinion, and you kind of learn a lot. And I really like the Peace Office, because I want to start an organization for young girls who have low self-esteem and body image, because I don't think adults really feel that that's a really serious topic. It's like, oh, we all go through that stage, but a lot of girls are in like really bad relationships because of it, because they're not loving themselves, but they're loving someone else, Also, it's like they want attention, so they're fighting, they're acting up, and then that's when the drug and the alcohol come in, or suicide, because they're not getting the attention from themselves. So I'm really, really hoping that 10 years from now, I can have a really big organization, which I want to be called Lady in Pink.
And Lady in Pink.
Mm-hmm. And I just want my, the man from the peace office, his name is Mr. Alexis, and he's helping me with the organization. So that's one of the biggest things I like about Parkway. You can start anything you would like, and it's a support team.
But when you walk around Parkway, what kinds of things do you see that you would love to see change? And I don't mean it just for Parkway. Yeah. I'm talking about the school system. I don't necessarily mean that it's unique to that school. Yes. I think it's just unique to schools,
Of course, I wish that the school is really small, and it's like an old building. So, of course, I want, like, you know, a newer building. But overall, it's a peace and social justice school. It's not a lot of violence. It's not, you know.
So there's no bullying going
on.
No
bullying that I know of at all. I wasn't into it. And that's pretty much the school district in general. I know that they're going through a financial kind of deficit right now, but Parkway itself is pretty good.
Oh, okay.
Let me chime in a little bit, and I want to both congratulate you both for being here, and I applaud you for being able to avoid all the negative obstacles that's presented in the communities where you guys live at. But I want to go back to the transformation from the ninth grade to the 10th grade, which is a critical, pivotal moment when a lot of kids get somewhat off base or entering into that high school arena where now I'm not with my normal core group of kids from the 7th, 8th, and 9th, and now you've transferred to high school. What challenges did you face during that transformation?
For one, coming out of middle school to high school, middle school is just a piece of cake compared to high school. When you get into high school, well, for one, personally, my middle school, we only had two classes, so we would transition from each class, and that was math and science, social studies, and reading. But in high school, it's this class, this period, and they will all give you a test on the same day, and you can't do anything about it. That was one of the hardest things, but I liked their work. As a freshman, it was easy to make friends because we were all new. When I got to the 10th grade and I was in a new school, everyone kind of knew each other and they were in their cliques. So it was kind of hard to kind of ease your way into each clique.
Yeah.
I think that's the hardest thing for coming to high school is, like, you get peer pressure because you want to have friends. So it could be something that's peer pressure, just as after school, instead of staying after school and doing your work, why don't you come to the mall with us? That's a slight peer pressure, but they can turn into, well, let's cut school today.
Yeah.
And then while we're cutting school, we're out doing something that we're not supposed to do. So that's one of the hardest things about coming into high school, is just trying to fit in.
Yeah, so the more you stayed on principles of doing what's right, you lost a lot of friends or associates or classmates or peers. And you mentioned earlier about being an NFL coach.
Yes.
Where did that come from?
Well, it was 2 years ago when the Saints, they won the Super Bowl. And Drew Brees, he was holding up the trophy, and then there was the confetti coming down, and he was holding up his son. It was just so much. Everybody was so happy. And earlier that day, I had watched, you know, before the Super Bowl, when they went around New Orleans and had everybody, you know, talk about how it uplifted them. And I was always into football. I actually started watching football because my brother, he liked football. I just wanted to be around him and ignore him. He's 2 years older than me, so I do whatever to get his attention. So he's sitting there watching football, so I slide next to him, and I'm like, who's that? I pulled out a piece of paper, and I was writing down notes. And he's like, you're so annoying, go away. You can't ask these kind of questions. So as I'm writing the notes, I'm like, oh, I like him. He's real good as a football player, you know. So then I'm like, I really like this. I wish I can do this. And then after seeing Drew Brees and all of the excitement, like, I want to be in that, like, business. I really want to
be. So you want to be a coach, NFL coach.
I want to be an
NFL
coach. That's
great.
Thank you.
Actually are doing a little coaching now in the sense of doing youth advocacy work.
Yes, yeah. I know.
In a sense, some of the principals. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about whether Jamal or whatever want to talk first. What do you do? I mean, I know you're with the youth movement in Philadelphia. Youth move. But what exactly are you doing with youth?
I mean, well, we, for the most part, we go around and we give, like, didactic lectures. Like, we make things interesting and as dynamic as possible, because sometimes when you hear grown-ups, they're talking about they go to a lecture or presentation, and then the grown-ups are like this by the time the presentation's over. So we want to make everything as interesting and vibrant as possible. We do a lot of skits, and we do role plays, and we do interactive games. So generally, we do almost, not almost anything, but we do anything positive to get our point across about youth advocacy.
And some of the role plays that you do would be, what kinds of issues would you be role playing?
I mean, most of the role plays would deal with like depression issues.
Oh, okay.
Or possibly if someone was autistic or other behavioral health related issues that may happen throughout a teenager and any adolescent or any adult's life.
Mm-hmm. Are some of these issues that you talk about particularly personal to you?
I would say an issue dealing with depression,
okay,
definitely, and self-esteem issues, and also foster care. Those would definitely be issues that pertain to me, because as far as depression, if you're a foster child, it's kind of rough, because when you walk into school, people's like, oh my goodness, he's a foster child, he's gonna stab somebody, he's gonna attack somebody. And so I'm like, no, I'm not angry just because I'm a foster child, I'm all right. So I mean, that definitely will cause a lot of issues, because people tend to shy away from people like that, people who they think are belligerent or generally angry. And then definitely, obviously, the foster care thing pertains to me because I'm a foster child. So definitely that will put me, if I was in a role play, I would be able to act that one out particularly well. And self-esteem issues, because you're as a foster child, you're trying to go through this sort of identity crisis, because you're trying to realize, okay, well, am I this person's child? Am I this person's foster child? Am I only this person's temporary child? What's going on with my mother? Who am I? Am I a foster child, or am I just Kareem? So mm-hmm. Those are issues you have to deal with, involving self-esteem in that scenario.
So let me ask you something, Kareem, and speaking about that, what's your daily activity like at your associates, your friends, your classmates, your peers?
My daily activity consists of a lot of dancing.
A lot of dancing.
I dance
a lot. That's your mechanism that you use to avoid all the negative things that you're faced with. When you say dance, do you go somewhere and you hang out with some people, and is it a form of exercise? What do you get out of dancing?
Generally, I get out of dancing. I love talking about dancing. I'm just thrilled about dancing. So, generally, dancing is a great way to meet people. Because, when I first moved in with my aunt as a foster child, I didn't, have any friends. And then my aunt, she was, a dancer. But, she got older. And, when you get older, your dancing slows down a little.
But the style of dance changed, right?
Two-step, right? She influenced me highly to start dancing. So I started dancing, and I started meeting people. And then, when I dance, I dance with an organization. Like, right now, I dance with Make a Change Performing Arts Company.
Okay.
Sometimes I just go hang with my friends, and I go dance.
Yeah.
So, I mean, dancing also poses and sets me up for a lot of goals in life, because sometimes, you can watch TV, and you see shows like America's Best Dance Crew, or So You Think You Could Dance, or Dancing with the Stars. And
yeah.
If you're a dancer, if you're a true dancer, you're going to want that goal. So me and my friends definitely want that. Me and my friend Tony Bennett, we're working on something right now.
Yeah.
So we definitely want to go out there and get big. And
that's cool, man. Yeah, one of the things that I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, both of you guys, when I say you guys, young lady and young gentleman here, is under the auspice of the Department of Behavioral Health of Randy Alexander, who's doing a phenomenal job with you guys over
yes.
there for the Department of Behavioral Health and the Office of Intellectual Disabilities. So, and again, we want to really thank him for having you guys come here, because, again, at those ages are very critical. And I know for myself personally, because I didn't have a father in my life,
yes.
I made some bad choices and decisions. And it only takes is to make one bad choice or decision that'll take you down a dark road.
Mm-hmm.
So for you guys to be here, sitting here, talking about your dreams, goals and aspirations, yes, come on.
Along the lines of making decisions and bad decisions in general, throughout the course of my life, or anybody's life, obviously, there have been bad decisions made.
Yeah.
Now, I believe that there's nothing in life that truly hinders us from success. Now, there are obstacles, but there are no true hindrances to success, in my opinion. So I say whatever bad decisions or bad choices we make, it's all about how we utilize the tools that we have, because I believe everyone is also has the tools to success, no matter if you are disabled in any way. Like, everybody has the tool to be successful and operate normally and formally in community. So I say it's all about how you choose to overcome that bad decision you made. I said that's very important. That's
key. So do you tell it to the other, your friends, because viewers, and I know that millions of kids are probably watching now. Do they get that?
I don't know if everybody understands it, but it's definitely a message I preach, like to like friends that I see every day.
People draw to
people
you.
People that I hang out with, like people I see, like they're like, oh, well, can you help me with this? Can you help me with that? Well, I'm like, well, if you need help, obviously you did something to get into the situation. So what did you do to get in the situation? Yeah. So, I mean, from that assessment, what they did to get in the situation, I try to think of a way so they can either better the situation or pull themselves out of the situation. And generally, it pulls over well for them. It goes well for them, you know. They get out of the situation. But sometimes it doesn't. I'm like, I can't help you there. But, you know, it's all about trying.
Great. You guys have been able to avoid the temptation of drugs and alcohol and being promiscuous sexually and just a bullying crowd and all that. Now, you mentioned you live in a neighborhood. We're not going to mention neighborhood. But you mentioned the fact that you don't interact or socialize with any particular person in that in the community, and you go to school and you come home and you're hanging out, you go elsewhere to hang out with your peers. What about you?
I'm the same. I get off the train and I walk straight home. I live in Logan, and it's not the best neighborhood to me. And when I first moved, I made friends with the people at the end of the block, but they're still, I don't know, just not my kind of people. I went to school at Filler Academics Plus School from first grade to eighth grade, and I never had to face, when students say that they had to face going through, they had to hide that they were smart, or people didn't accept them because they were smart. But that was the cool thing in my school. You were smart. I got all A's and B's. Well, how many A's did you get? Because I got 5. How many you got? And it's like, oh, man, I got to step my A's up. So it's always been like that. So when I get around these people in these neighborhoods and they're not really into school, I'm like, you don't want to go to college? You don't want to do this? You don't want to do that? So I just can't associate my time with those kind of people because I feel like they'll bring me down.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting that both of you, appear to have almost got isolated in your life in order to succeed up through the 10th grade at least. And, you know, I wonder if that's how some people do survive.
Yeah.
And avoid drugs and maybe have related depression and, low self-esteem. But it seems like to be successful in the sense of non-drug use, et cetera, you almost have to avoid a significant amount of your colleagues. And I wonder if that was a conscious decision you made or it was just something that you just kind of got turned off to, or?
I would say that is definitely a conscious decision.
Oh, okay.
Like when you're in an environment and like if you can walk on the corner or you can walk down the street and see all these guys wasting their lives on the corner every day. If you're on the way to school and they're still on that corner when you get back and when you leave from school, there's something wrong with them. So those are the people you don't associate with because obviously they're not on the path to success because sitting on the corner all day is not success. Not at all.
The question is, how did you get there?
Yeah.
I mean, how do you find that space where so many young people just fall victim to the peer pressure?
Yeah, was it like a spiritual?
Yeah, what happened?
You go to church? I mean, something had to happen for you to say, you know what? Clearly, you saw that all those things were negative, but not being positively pulled that way because of what's presented to you.
The thing that I saw that actually made me definite make a turnaround, because I was already like, look, I don't really like this neighborhood. I wasn't really with it, but I was still kind of skeptical because I'm like, oh, well, they seem like they're pretty in whatever. But no, I decided one day, I don't know if anyone remembers, but on the news, there was this boy that was shot around my neighborhood and his name was Kareem. So he had the same name as me. So in my head, I'm like, well, that could have easily been me. Like this Kareem. Yeah. So I'm in my head like, no, I definitely don't want that. So I could say that was the definite turning point. Like that was like the definitive point that said, no, like I just can't associate with these people. I have to find somewhere else to interact and somewhere else to flourish or to flourish on my own.
Yeah. We mentioned earlier, you mentioned the fact that you wanted to be an NFL coach. And my question to you, Kareem, is what dreams and aspirations are set for you right now?
I mean, well, there are a few ways like that I could possibly go, but my main focus is to just go to college right now. I want to get a degree in business so I can go into business with my brother and open an automotive type thing. I want to be able to own the business and manage the business. I want my brother to be able to work on the cars. And then I want to get a degree in social science so I can work with Mr. Randy. But I mean, my smallest goal, my longest standing goal has always been to be like a professional dancer and to be a professional choreographer. And I want to like definitely be on TV and go really big with dancing because it's really a passion of mine and something I love.
Cool.
You had spoken earlier that you had issues around foster care and low self-esteem, mm-hmm. also, and then you mentioned a couple other issues that you had challenges around, and in particular one was depression. And you know, depression's a real critical issue in a lot of young adolescent growth, and I was wondering what kind of a depression did you have, and how did that challenge get managed by you? Because you seem, at least today, you seem like you're very, very positive and you're in the right space and moving in the right direction. So it might be helpful to the audience to hear like how you got there.
When I first moved in with my aunt, or maybe a little bit before that, like I wasn't really compelled or motivated to do anything. Like I was always housebound. I didn't have much energy to get up and do anything. I didn't see any point in really trying or aspiring at all to any type of greatness or any type of success. So I would definitely say that would throw me in the category of depression right there, just that alone. And I was dissatisfied with any and everything that came across me. But you know, as I got older and I moved out, or as I started getting older and I started realizing things around me, it's something in my head just clicked. Yeah. And it just told me like, you can't stay like this.
It wasn't an event that helped click it, or?
I think the event that helped to click it would have been like me seeing people around me fall, like lower than me. And obviously, I was already depressed. I was already falling.
Depression of the neighborhood.
Yeah, like you see people around you, and they're doing worse off than you. And it's like, well, I'm depressed already. I know I'm not going to do anything. I might end up like him. But in your head, you're like, I don't want to be like him.
Yeah.
So that would definitely be something to turn you around. From depression, it's like, well, I got to go out and do something. And I guess when you're depressed or when you're down in the dumps or anything along those lines, just simply with the case of the blues, getting out and finding something to focus on is definitely not a definite remedy, but it's a solid. It's pretty solid. You find something positive to do. And for me, it was dance.
What survival support mechanisms did you actually start putting in place? The very moment you saw the negative things around you, you said, well, maybe I got, you know, what support mechanisms did you start developing?
Or who was around you that was giving you the support?
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, the people around me that were giving me the support, well, this is before the youth committee when I finally got over, like, the whole big depression deal. So, like, the people who were around me who gave me support would definitely have been my brother.
Okay.
And it would have to be my friends that I met through dancing because they're, like, cheerful, super funny, hilarious people.
Okay.
And then, you know, I met a lot of people from the church, even though, like, I'm not particularly religious, but I met people who are from the church. And
that had a good positive
positive feel about them. And then, you know, I got a girlfriend eventually, and she's a good person. She's a great person. I'm still with her now. So those are the things that definitely help me stay solid. You know, anybody sees me going astray, they're like, well, you have to focus because you have big goals. Like, you can't afford to fall victim to drugs and alcohol and sex pressure and everything else because you have to focus on success.
Yeah. How did you get connected with Mr. Alexander?
Actually, it was word of mouth.
Really?
And yeah, actually, I was in school and some girl told me, she was like, well, there's this youth committee thing that you should really come join. And I'm like, all right, why should I join it? And they're like, she's like, well, there's a bunch of girls there, and she's like, well, there's food, and
yeah.
You can help people, and you can do positive things. So I would say that's something that definitely drew me in, because I'm like, well, positive things, food, you know, girls, you can't really beat that. You got all three.
Them.
It's good. So,
Keyshawn, does any of this make any sense to you in the sense of his story? Do you have a similar kind of? I don't get the impression there was depression in your life, but low self-esteem and depression could very easily cross into each other without any difficulty.
Well, it crossed then. I remember being in about the seventh grade, and my mom just, this was before I figured it's a low self-esteem. And it was just like, I was angry. That's when I really started developing like an attitude problem because I felt like nobody understands me. No, like, I felt like I was distant and everybody around me just didn't understand. So I was very angry. I developed an attitude. We just had left Georgia and I felt like I really liked Georgia. I was having a good start there and we just moved. But we came to Georgia on the strength of my brother who was acting up, and then we left Georgia because he couldn't adapt there. So it's still like, hey, look at me. I was enjoying Georgia. I was learning. So I remember I was in the seventh grade and I wrote a suicide note. But it was just so for attention. I wrote the full note and then gave it to one of my friends and then said, I'm not coming to school tomorrow because I'm going to kill myself.
Mm-hmm.
And that was fully.
We take those notes seriously, you know,
yes,
in adolescence.
Exactly. Yeah. But I just look, now that I look back at it, it's just like you just wanted attention because you handed it to your friend and then told her to hand it to another friend so everybody can read the suicide note. And then they all like, you better come to school tomorrow. It was the attention that I wanted. And then I wrote one like a couple months later and I let my mom read it. And then my mom, she didn't really like, you know, it didn't really hit her because I guess she knew, she looked at it as it's not a big thing. What you're upset over is plenty more things in the world. And so it was like, it was kind of a lingering depression.
Well, you wrote two suicide notes. And let's assume that it's not uncommon actually in adolescence for people to kind of think with low self-esteem and write kind of suicide notes. And in the field, in the clinical field, we tend to take them very seriously because if you look at the actual suicide rates among adolescents and older adults, they're the two where the two high rates are. But I want to know, why did you write them? You said to get attention. Attention for what?
Because
what were you thinking what was the result going to be of the suicide notes?
Just to get the attention. My younger sister, she sort of struggles in school, like reading math. And she's the youngest, she dances, and she's real, you know, outgoing, and I'm just not like that. I'm, like, outgoing, but I'm not the dancer. I couldn't dance if I tried. And so she got a lot of attention as the younger one. My brother got a lot of attention as the oldest one, and because he was getting into a lot of trouble. And then I'm in the middle getting A's and B's, but it's just like, oh, she always gets A's and B's. It's really nothing. So I kind of wrote it, and it's just like, and I put in a note, like, Mom, I hope you feel guilty. The note, and it was just, I think I got in trouble in school that day, and I just, it just was like, I'm so fed up. And that's like a big thing with lingering depressions. Like, I always been like a tiny bit depressed because I'm missing something, but it's something so small that I just take so big because I'm just really like depressed, but it's just small, it's just lingering.
Now it's even lingering.
Yes, it's lingering. I think that.
And how old are you now?
16. I think that it's in my family, though. I think because my older cousin, I call her my sister because she's lived with me all my life. She has that kind of lingering depression also, and she actually loses weight and gains weight as she's depressed. So one day I'll see her, and she's really skinny, and she'll be, oh, this is going on and this going on, and then a month later she'll be big and. Mm-hmm. And she's happy, and so I just, and my mom is also the same way. I just think it's a family thing.
Yeah. There are some studies that would show that there is a relationship between generation to generation around depression. But I'm curious, did either one of you ever seek out any kind of professional help, or you just figured that's a part of growing up and being an adolescent, and you just kind of found friends that were helpful, or support groups that we say sometimes in the field?
No, I never really sought out any professional help because I guess this is just something that I've been raised with.
Yeah, and I'm not saying you should have,
because
I'm just asking the questions.
Like, it's something I've been raised with because generally people in, now I'm not trying to stereotype here, but generally people in African American communities tend to stray away from any psychological or any government oriented help. So, I mean, I guess that's something that was instilled in me, and I guess I've always been a particularly independent person, so most of my problems I sort out on my own.
Okay. So there's a natural, I guess, dislike, or there's a natural suspicion of, quote, the therapist types.
I actually would ask my mom if I could see a therapist or something, but because she thought it was so small, you know, what do you need a therapist for? And I would be in the counselor's office for hours just telling her, you know, everything. So I just felt like I just wanted somebody to talk to. But then after a while, it was like, okay, talking is not really helping this. I want some action. So that's basically what I'm working on now. I go like networking parties and different things. Because I think instead of trying to love myself like the way I look, and because my mom once told me the people with the most money in the world, the most successful people in the world, are depressed and don't love themselves as much as they do. So I'm working towards success and like getting mm-hmm. over this also.
Yeah, and I wanted to find out how she also get connected to Mr. Randy Alexander.
Oh yeah.
Now he found out through school partner. Mm-hmm. How did you meet Mr. Alexander?
It was in the seventh grade, and my mom was like, "You need to do something," because as I said, my sister dances, and my brother was into football. So I was always like, "Okay, so what are you gonna do?" So she was like, "You need to start this program," and I'm like, "I don't really want to." And then she said, "I heard them talk, and you know, people have stories," and I'm thinking, "I don't have a story. I don't have nothing that's like traumatic." And so she was like, "Well, you have to do it," and I went, and Mr. Randy, he had donuts at the interview. I said, "I'm gonna love this place." Donuts. They just ended a meeting. There was chips behind me. I said, "Oh, I can get used to this."
Yeah.
So the meeting, the interview went well, and then I came to the next meeting, more food, and then everyone was kind of welcoming. We had name tags, because this was back in May of 2008. So everyone was kind of fresh, name tags, and so we all got to get to know each other. And now when people come to the group, I'm the person to walk around like, "Hi, what's your name? Come sit next to me," like that, because that's how everybody pretty much was to me.
Great.
You know what's interesting is that it almost gives the impression that, and I really support this thought, that social networking is probably more important, and we think of adolescence and, you know, peer relationships, et cetera, but probably more important than actually seeing someone individually. It's almost like if there's enough support out there for you, enough social programs, if you want to look at it that way, that you can actually find your resilience and make the transformation into adulthood, even if you technically would have something called depression or low self-esteem. It doesn't have to be handled in the traditional sense. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if you can comment on some of that topic of this non-traditional way of finding alleviating pain in your life, so to speak.
I would say basically the methods that both of us use to kind of combat depression or to combat any negative influence on our life is far from traditional, because most people either they just deal with it and they fall victim to everything that comes in their path, or they go seek either psychological help or they take medicine and use other outside external aids. But we tend to focus more on activities or more on other, like we find something positive and stick to it, as opposed to the traditional, you know, "Well, I'm going to sit down and talk to a therapist, he's going to prescribe me some medicine, and that's the end of it," because that is not truly going to end depression. It's not going to solve depression, because once your medicine runs out and you're too lazy to go fill the prescription again, you're sad again.
And one might suspect that the reason people are depressed during adolescence is because they're not active enough and don't have a social network in which they could talk with people and enjoy life with people and get to know different women and, you know, and enjoy, you know, what happens in adolescence without necessarily the use of alcohol or drugs. And I'm always, you know, impressed by the both of you that somehow you didn't fall victim to very traditional kind of adolescent activity.
Indeed.
I think it's all about taking that first step.
Yeah.
When you take the first step to go get out there, I was watching this thing on TV and they were talking about how this guy, he was like 30 and he was still living at home. And they said, "Well, he's not going to learn anything until you push him out there and let him fall." And I believe sometimes in life you have to give yourself that push. Like, you have to be willing to go out there and like meet somebody, like even if you're going to argue with this person or you're going to get into a conflict, you have to be willing to take that risk, because once you take that risk, sometimes you move on to greater things and you have the potential, and that gives you the chance to move on to greater things. The probability of success if you sit in the house all day is zero. So your best bet is to go out there and try something.
Yeah.
Another thing is direction. And like I said, I always had a problem with direction, like where was I going? And I remember when I was younger, I wanted to be a singer. And my dad, like me and my dad would write letters in jail. And he like, "No, I want you to be a lawyer. You're so smart and you really know how to write. You can really be a lawyer." And I'm like, "No, I want to be a singer." I couldn't sing at all. I don't know why I wanted to be a singer.
Well, that was a good choice then, right?
Yes.
Not to be a singer.
Over time, I ended up wanting to be a lawyer. And then it's just like, So I was working towards that. I usually set high expectations for myself, mm-hmm. and that's something I often tell people. Either you can set like short distance goals, or you can set, you know, higher distance goals. Short distance goals for me was just trying to make sure I made honor roll each semester.
Okay.
That yeah. way, it will, all the honor rolls can come together, and I can be at the top of my class.
Right.
So I set high goals for myself. So because I wanted to be a lawyer, I strived. But then when I started to feel like I don't want to be a lawyer, and then it's like, well, what do I want to be? That's when it's no direction, and it's just like, well, I don't know what I want to do. It really was a point in my life when it was just like, I don't care about anything. I'm not even going to be successful. I'm not. So I just think people should just have some kind of direction where you want to go. Even if you don't know exactly what you want to do in life, just know that it's somewhere you want to get. Because once I figured out I want to be an NFL coach, it was just like, okay, I started going, like I said before, networking parties. And people kind of had somebody was just a personal assistant for an NFL player. But I talked to her and she told me several things I can do to get up there. So it was like just a sense of direction. You may be blindfolded, but long as you're walking on a straight path, you can get there.
There's no female NFL coaches out there, are there?
Nope.
So when you become that person,
yes.
Can I get a job?
Sure.
I'll just, you know, be standing beside you there somewhere. Have you met any, you mentioned the assistant. Have you been able to network and meet Andy Reid or anybody else?
No.
Have you been to the Eagles game?
That's another hard thing. It's just, I feel like I don't know where to start. And I tried, I went to this Moxie, this woman Moxie conference, thanks to Mr. Randy. And what was real influential was, it was a bunch of women there, and it was like, I was the first this, I was the first that, I was the first, and it was just like, wow. And when I tell people I want to be an NFL coach, and they say, you can't be an NFL coach, and then people tell me, there once was a time when they said that African Americans was not smart enough to be a quarterback, or like, it was a time when, so it's like, never say never. And of course it sounds cheesy, but we have an African American president, and it was a time when it just was like, there could never be an African American president.
Yeah.
So I know that I can get there, but yes, it is kind of hard.
Well, I'm going to try to make some connections for you so you can get an opportunity to meet Coach Andy Reid.
Yes,
so
that would help.
I'm going to do that for you. Yeah.
Well, you know, it's interesting that they both talk about role models, and they both talk about the influence of people in power,
yeah.
people who are successful. And you always hear stories about, you know, XYZ person, football player or basketball player or whatever, that goes to a high school and talks to people, and you realize how influential they really can be. And when they fall, how influential they could really be, you know, when they're,
yeah.
you know, doing drugs and get apprehended for, you know, domestic violence or something like that. And I wonder if what needs to happen, in the sense of talking about Philadelphia Move and other groups, is that we need to bring celebrities to meet people more like
mm-hmm.
yeah.
these young people, so that they could have this better exchange of potentially where they want to go. And role models are, you know, particularly
yes.
critical, I think, in adolescence or young adulthood.
When I thought about my organization that I wanted to have called Lady in Pink,
mm-hmm.
that's one of the things that I would like to do, is have you know, women, models, just famous people, because they know what kind of influence they have on the young teens, and the media has one of like the biggest influence on us. It's the rappers, and they talk about guns and drugs, and they just make it seem so cool. You look in the videos and they have all the money that we wish we had, and they have, you know, the girls swarming around them and publicity, but they're rapping about guns and drugs. So of course,
and killing
yes.
and all kinds of stuff.
And so, and the women, they are very influential, and actually having low self-esteem, you look at these women like, oh my goodness, they're so beautiful. But I know everybody had a stage in their life when it's just like, I don't like the way I look. So definitely for my organization, Lady in Pink, I would really like for famous women or just high to just come and let the girls know that everyone has the stage in life, and you can overcome it.
Well, I assume Michelle Obama fits into that
of
category.
Of course.
She's a very successful person
yes.
in the sense of what she's doing right now across the country and,
mm-hmm.
and her concerns about obesity and,
yes.
and other topics. So it's kind of interesting that, yes, you know, we talk about the president, and we're very happy that he's there, and you know, many of us felt comfortable in moving, that he moved mm-hmm. into that position. But you don't realize how impactful he is on lots of other things, his wife, his children.
Indeed.
And the kind of influence they have, particularly in the African-American community.
So you mentioned our role models.
Who are you?
Did you have any particular role models? You're mentioning dance, and I started thinking, like, dancing. What is it and who is it that sparked that in you?
I mean, like, I was watching So You Could Dance one day, and then there was a dancer, Philip Chabib, and, like, he was just, like, an amazing dancer. Now, everything he did fascinated me. And even after, like, he didn't even win. He didn't win a show. But after, like, he won, like, he had a YouTube account, and he did, like, a lot of things on YouTube that were, like, really good to me, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So, like, that definitely inspired me to, like, push harder in dancing, because when I started dancing, I couldn't dance to train, like, to save my life.
Like, you couldn't sing.
Yeah, like when generally when people have a talent, it's normally natural, but like dancing is definitely like something that I kind of forced upon myself, because it's something I wanted to do and it's something I wanted to learn. So I mean, after that, like now he's on America's Best Dance Crew now, a couple years later, trying out another dance show. So I'm definitely rooting for him now. So those are my general inspirations, like really famous dancers. And I see, like, if you look at his lifestyle, if you do a little bit of research on him, you see that, like, he's going to college and he helps with charity events, and he's living basically a successful lifestyle off of dancing. And generally, when people think of dancer, they think, well, that's pretty low income. But you can make an honest and make a solid living off of dancing, and you can still be a positive influence and a positive role model to people.
So now you're both in 10th grade, and, you know, I guess in another year you'll be thinking of school, college, and things like that. And mm-hmm. I know both of you are thinking about it already.
Yes.
Where do you think you're going to wind up in the sense of your aspirations for college? And you know, you have two more years in high school. I know that.
I was looking into sports administration or sports management, and a lot of schools called it different things, but I believe it's like this national thing that they're putting this in colleges now to either get your bachelor's or your master's. So I go on the website and I look at different schools, and I was looking at the University of Miami. They've been sending me a lot of like pamphlets and things like that. Hampton, I was looking at Hampton. I was looking at Columbia. And those were my top choices. Mm-hmm. But of course, I'm gonna look deeper into the schools.
Now, are there a lot of students in the school thinking like you're thinking, or are they thinking differently?
Again, my friends are. I always been hung around people. Like I said, even when I was in middle school, it was always a race of who got more A's and less B's. So now that I'm in high school, it's the same thing. Is you staying after school with me today? To do what? Oh, I have to do this project, or I have to do this. So we all really had that motivation. I actually copied off my friend about going to Columbia. She said, I want to go to Columbia. It's one of the top schools. It's an Ivy League school, blah, blah, blah. She get the talking. Then I sneak behind her back, Google it. Then it's like, oh, I want to go to Columbia too. So we all pretty much into the college thing.
Yeah.
Cool. Any particular school you're thinking about, Kareem?
I was thinking about Temple University,
Temple University?
Yeah. They offer a lot. And I get to stay in Philadelphia, stay close to my family, you know. Okay. I'm pretty family oriented, because you see a lot of people aren't very connected with their family, so you definitely want to remain networked with your family. And also, Temple just offers a lot, and it's generally a good college, so I would definitely want to take that opportunity. Mm-hmm. And I hear there are a lot of grants and things like that for people who live in Philadelphia actually applying for a Philadelphia college, so definitely want to take a whack at that.
Do you see yourself working in human service?
Yes.
You know, I wonder how many young people in the high schools that you're in really have that kind of an interest.
Not a lot. Like a lot of, like, I was talking to some of my friends, and like some of them want to be like, it's like, oh, well, I want to be a rapper, or I want to be a football player, or I want to be a basketball player. And I'm like, blah, blah, I've heard it like a billion times. Mm-hmm. Like, you hear it in kindergarten, you hear it when you walk down the street, how everybody's going to be the next best rapper, next best this, next best that. Like, I'm not worried about it. I want something more solid. You know, definitely something that's going to pay well and it's going to be positive, definitely, because just being a football player itself doesn't make you positive. Like, you could be a horrible football player you'd be a great player, but with a horrible personality, and you can go out and get drunk and do everything negative. But as a social worker, you don't get very much camera time, so that's an advantage.
Yeah.
Now, have you guys both had summer jobs?
Actually, yeah,
yes.
We did. Actually, working with Mr. Randy. our youth summer program, actually, from August, from I think it was July the 26th to August the 26th, we had that whole time occupied working with Mr. Randy. And we had the pleasure of training other five new recruits into the group, into the youth move.
Wow, how empowering is that?
I've actually been to all three of them. I was at the first, the second, and the third. And it's so funny just to see how it's so different each time and how my role changes in each one. This year I actually got to just teach all my peers about resilience because that's my topic. So I got to teach them about that, and this year was actually pretty fun. We got to put together a skit. We broke up into groups, and we got to put into skit. And Dillis, as you mentioned before, she's up there. Me and her are always battling head-to-head, like I said, debates. She always have her opinion, and it's always funny because she's a little older than me, so it's always back and forth. So Mr. Randy put Dillis in charge of one and then me in charge of the other, so it's like, we're going to be better than them. Come on, guys, we're serious. So we got to put together a little skit that we can do in schools, and I did more of a classroom setting. So my team, it was about 11 of us, was sitting in rows, and then they would raise their hand and just give their topic, and I called them out on roll as suicide, such and such, such and such. It was really creative. Yeah. Then we went to present it in front of everybody, and then Dilla's team stole my idea because they went second, because we like, we're going first, we're going to kick their butts, we're going to show them. Yeah. Then they went, and they stole our idea. We're like, oh, man. But it was all around really good. It's always good to see, like, how everybody, we really came up a lot.
That's great. Mm-hmm. And you guys are going around different schools, community groups, civic organizations, exposing the youth movement.
One of the funnest things is the national conferences. We get to go to the national conference. And I've had the pleasure of going to three. I went to Washington, D.C., I went to Maryland, and I went to Atlanta. And I never really flew on a plane before until then. So we got to fly on a plane to Atlanta, and it was really nice. And we go to these conferences, and we're not the only conference, the only workshop. So we get to go to other workshops, and it's just, so we kind of say, oh, we came to your workshop, so come to ours. Because it's a volunteer basis to come to our workshop. So we spend the first couple of days like, come to our workshop, we're talking about this.
Yeah.
So you're not really sure what kind of audience you're going to get, because you're from Philadelphia, so they're from Ohio, and they're from all these other places, because it's national. So they're really, we're out of Philadelphia, really spreading our work. And then when it's over, we always have a bunch of people, that was so nice, can we have your car? We want to do this, we want to do that. It's really nice.
Well, as an NFL coach, get used to flying.
Yes.
Get used to flying.
Yes.
And Kareem, I'm quite sure destiny waits for you. And we'll hopefully be looking for you somewhere in Broadway, or to play, or some major television station doing the great things you like to do.
Definitely. Like right now with Make a Change Performing Arts Company, we definitely want to get out there. We want to get our, in a sense, get our feet wet as far as performances and, going around doing local shows and everything like that. But I definitely want to improve and work hard in my goals, being a choreographer or being a professional dancer, because I want to have that on the side as well, in case anything ever doesn't go well. I want to have multiple opportunities and options, in case I can't be a social worker. Yeah. And I end up being a dancer, or in case I can't be a dancer, I want to be a social worker. Yeah. Or if either of those don't pan out, I want to be in business for my brother. So you always want to have a backup plan.
Indeed.
And a backup for that backup. And that backup.
Yeah, they're so, both of you are kind of very unique in the sense of what you traditionally think of when you listen to young people in high school. I mean, there's so many other confusing things going on in our lives. You both seem to have a level of maturity that I wonder if I could package it somewhere and sell it.
I tell
you. I wonder if you could you share some issues about how did you get so together, so to speak, and avoid all these things?
Mine is just pretty much looking at, like Kareem said, the people around you, but it's actually people in my family. My mom, she's very, very intelligent, and she struggles in math just as I do. And she's in college right now working for a master's degree, and she's in the bathroom like, I can't believe this happened today. So I walked in like, what's going on? I got an 85 on my math test. And I'm looking at her like, an 85? She said, yes, now my GPA went down from a 96 to a 94. And it's just really weird to see, like, she's just like me, just an overachiever. And it's just sad to see that she had got pregnant in her 12th grade year and she could have went to college. And she could have went to college. And then I see my other sister, well, my cousin who I grew up with and I call my sister, she was in the 12th grade when she got pregnant also. And it's just like, you just see everybody around you with so much potential and they're falling. And it just makes you want to put your head on straight. And sometimes I have to be mean to like the boys and it's like, no, I don't even want to talk to anybody. My friends, I don't even want to be around where the boys is going to be. And it's just all because I'm like, I cannot make any mistakes. I can't, I don't want anybody to get in my way.
Interesting.
Very interesting.
Yeah, very interesting that you didn't allow negative life experiences to impact on you. And I remember you told me, and I don't remember if we discussed it today, that your father had been in and out of prison. So you didn't let that affect you very negatively either. You figured it's a life experience and you have to deal with it and you'll, you know.
My brother was affected by that because now he's in jail.
His son
was born in September, but he didn't get a chance to see him just yet. So he's 7 months. He's so cute and fit. And it's just like, I hope it's not a cycle. So I really just feel like, I feel like sometimes I don't want to have any children. My dad has about 10 or 12 kids. I can take care of everybody. I'll just be successful and I can just take care of everybody so nobody won't fall into that pattern. That's really my goal, to just not let anybody fall into the pattern.
Now your organization, again, that you're going to develop, Ladies in Pink.
Yes.
They're going to be very, they're going to love you.
Thank you.
You have such an enormous level of wealth and knowledge and stern and direct. So they're going to benefit from being in your organization.
Yes, thank you.
Yes.
Kareem, what were you thinking? I mean, you have, again, both of you, as I mentioned, you had an experience that seems to have not allowed the negative of your life to overwhelm you and take you over. I mean, coming out of foster care and being in neighborhoods where you had to kind of avoid certain blocks in order to get home, and these are things that you've explained to me off camera. And I'm wondering, does her story sound ring or resonate with you in the sense of?
Definitely. And on the terms of me and Keyshawn, I believe we are two very alike and yet two very different people. Because we're both very different because of our goals and how we go about accomplishing those. And we're alike because like of our background and our lifestyle, because like we both grew up in kind of a rough neighborhood. Her father was in prison, my father was in prison and still is in prison. And our families are also going through some turmoil, but we both remain focused on our goals. So I guess that's something that definitely makes us alike. But growing up, my factors that definitely kept me positive, they were just wondrous. I guess it's just willpower and drive that keeps you going. It's the drive to not be, you know, the question to be or not to be. Well, I guess to not to be would be the answer in this scenario. You don't want to be negative, so you go and be successful.
Okay. Well, I want to thank both of you for spending time with us today.
Yes.
Thank you.
Was very, very helpful. It's nice to hear that there's these positive role models out there, and both of you surely reflect that, and you're to be congratulated for that.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, that's all the time we have today. I want to thank my guests for being with us today, and I want to thank you for watching. If you would like more information about the topic, please contact us at the college. I am Pascal Scoles, Professor of Behavioral Health and Human Services at Community College of Philadelphia. You have been watching Tapestry of Life on CCP-TV. See you next time. Thank you.